In the previous part of this tutorial, I showed you a super useful trick on how to transfer your 3D trees into 2D particles, or rather, billboards as they are called. We used various passes, created a material, and made these planes look semi-3-dimensional. Seeing this resulting shot, however, many of you asked two questions. How did I create this environment, and how did I scatter the trees on it? When it comes to the first question, I'm afraid this has a rather disappointing answer. I actually bought a pre-made environment map on CG Trader, added a camera, lighting, and atmosphere to it, and bam, that was it. You can go ahead to this video on my personal channel to learn more details about it. Rest assured though, in my Master 3D Environments course in Blender, I go into step-by-step detail on every single workflow I use. When it comes to the second question though, this tutorial is here to answer everything about it. I will show you two ways to scatter. First, the particle, and second, the geometry node way. With the arrival of geometry nodes, I think that particle setups will gradually become less and less used in Blender. However, I actually still use this workflow pretty often and see nothing wrong with it. Sure, it's not as robust as geonodes, but one doesn't always need robust to achieve simple results. Let's have a look at some steps on how to use particles to scatter our 2D trees. First, you need to have a geometry onto which you want to distribute all particles. In my case, it was this mountainous terrain that, as mentioned, I got from CG Trader. But you can just as easily use, for example, an ANT landscape. Let's say this large terrain here. And if you don't see this menu, just activate the ANT in the add-on section here. But in my case, I'll stick to my terrain. And yeah, on its own, it doesn't look nearly as detailed as I'd like it to be. That's when our trees come in real handy. Speaking of trees, you're also gonna need the billboards on a special collection, like we've done in the previous part of this tutorial. As you can see, I already have it here, AST_trees. Next up, add your particle system and switch to hair. You can name the system and the slot. The very first step I do, I source my particles here. So collection and trees. Let's see here. You'll probably want to increase the scale first. Well, they are lying on the ground. That's because I haven't enabled the rotation menu, which you can do with this advanced checker. Then check the rotation. And usually I choose global y-axis to make my particles point up in my scene. Why y-axis, you ask? Well, from some strange reason, while Blender uses z-axis as up in its 3D scenes, when using particles, it requires the particle to lay on the ground to make it point upwards. If you don't do it, like in the case of our 2D trees, you will have to get around this by setting y-axis here. To randomize this, I often use scale randomness of about 0.4 and a tiny bit of rotation randomness. Having this amount of particles, however, makes your scene pretty heavy. So for that, I often like to add children instead of thousands of base particles. These are basically instances of your instances, making the scene easier to compute. I usually use interpolated children since they fill the spaces between the base particles much better than the simple ones. Anyways, this now gets really, really hard to work with. The viewport response slowed down, and that's because we now have gazillion billboard trees in our scene. Not to mention, if we hit render, there is now 100 children particles set for each of the base particles. Let's find a workable amount though. For example, 4,000 trees with about 30 children. What you sometimes see me doing too though, to allow faster viewport work, is that I set quick proxies for my source particles. It's basically just substituting or simplifying the preview of our trees here for something less geometry heavy. Just select all your trees, go to this menu, and let's select, for example, this wire option. If you hold down Alt while having all the tree particles selected, it will change the settings for all of them at once. Sometimes with really heavy scenes, this is the best way to preview them. It shows you where the particles are, but it doesn't obstruct the view. And don't worry, once you render your scene, the particles will be there in their shaded form, of course. Nevertheless, once you're done with setting your particles and you're happy with the way it looks, You can also deactivate them altogether with this screen button. And as long as you leave this camera button on, it will not be visible in the viewport. But again, it will show up in your render. Also, you can always limit the number of children particles in this simplify menu here. There are of course many other settings in these particle setups, but I think at this point it's necessary to mention only one. And that is weight map painting. Something I do all the time in my workflows is assigning vertex groups to these particle systems to drive the density, scale, and other options. All that is done by creating custom weight maps. First, let me actually deactivate the particles for a bit. And then you go to this menu here, create a vertex group with this plus button, and then just paint in the weight paint mode. First off, let me actually increase the weight in this right click menu here, or you can choose the Ctrl F shortcut, which is super handy. And newly, you can also control the visibility of the weight painting here. Finally, let me rename the group to trees, and then in the particle settings, go down here to the vertex groups and choose it in density. Wherever you paint this red color, the trees will then appear there. Let me actually reactivate the particles. There you go. The particles now appear only when there is no blue color. For landscape meshes like these, there is in fact even better option than just painting by hand, which can get real-time consuming. In the Create Shelf menu here, we have this Weight from Slope option, and that, set to its default mode, creates this map for use. It basically eliminates all the vertical areas where the trees probably won't grow, and leaves all the horizontal areas. At this point, if I use it, it is kinda too intense all over. So the trees still appear even on the green areas, though less frequently. What I want is to increase the contrast of these areas, or rather, retain the red ones, but make the green ones cyan and blue to get rid of the trees there. For that, let's use this levels option here. By itself, it doesn't do much, but set the offset lower to negative numbers, like negative 0.8, and you can see everything was dimmed down significantly. Now we only need to add some gain to these remaining areas, so set it high, like 8. The result is this map, which is exactly what we aimed for. What I dislike is the fact that the trees occur even up here, at the highest peaks. For that, however, you can always draw manually over this map. I recommend turning off the particles for this, and also duplicating the map here. Select this duplicate, rename it, and then you can go to a side view, choose this gradient tool in linear mode, and make sure you have zero weight here. Now, if you drag down on the top of your mountain, and if you hold down Ctrl while doing it, you will lock the direction to vertical axis, and you can get rid of just the top portions here. Then, just use this new cutoff map here, activate the particles, and look at the result. If, like me, you already have your camera set up, using this gradient tool, you can always just cut off all the areas that will not be visible. I in fact recommend doing it, because you will save some performance that way. You don't have to limit yourself only to this gradient tool, you can always employ the draw brush to draw away some specific areas. And since this way we've shrunk down the region significantly, you can even lower the amount of particles. But yeah, this is how I achieved my particle setup. By the way, I just wanted to briefly mention this super handy CG Boost shortcut PDF for Blender, where you'll find all the important shortcuts you need to know. You can get it for free from our resources section, link is in the description below. Of course, geometry nodes are still all the buzz. So in this tutorial, I also wanted to show you how to use them to achieve a very similar result. So first off, let's set up our menus. You can quickly click this plus button, and in this general tab, find the geometry node setup. Though I don't think I'll be needing this window for our workflow. So just drag this corner and get rid of it. What you will find is that you'll probably need to increase the clipping here to not have the terrain cut off like this. So let's click on the new geometry node group here. And really, this is very similar to creating a new shader in the material editor. This created a new network, and you can see there's an input, which is the geometry that we feed in, and an output, the geometry that comes out of the process after we've done with it. Right now, there is nothing extra on our network, so the input is identical to the output. However, we'll change it fast by adding our first node. Oh, by the way, check this modifier menu. By creating the geometry node network, it was automatically added here as a modifier. And from there, you can apply it, you can switch for other networks, or deactivate it. Now, think of each node that we are going to add as a sort of an effect, or yeah, even a modifier, only in a different form. So let's say I want to scatter lots of little points on this terrain, onto which we'll add our trees. For that, we use the point distribute points on faces node. Add it here, and let's see what it does. Well, it's generated a heck of a lot of points, and our plane disappeared, but we'll fix that later. Right now, you can lower the density of points. We will not need nearly as many. 0.02 will be okay for now. Well, let's see how to go about scattering our trees onto this point. For that, we'll go to this instances menu and choose the instance on points, which does, well, pretty much what it says in the name of it. It instances anything we choose onto these points we see. Now we don't see them, but that's just because we haven't plugged anything into the node yet. So next up, add a collection info node. Plug the geometry output to the instance socket and pick your AST trees collection. And bam, here we go. We have scattered the trees onto our terrain. And you can now see that the system scattered the whole collection onto every single point. So don't forget to check this option, which results into the geometry nodes always picking randomly just one of the assets in the collection. For that to work, you also need to check this separate children checker here in the collection info. Also, to remove the transform of each of the collection's children so that they are instanced directly onto the point where we want it, you can check this reset children. I usually check both of these. Now, of course, there's still a lot more we can do to imitate the way we scatter assets with particle systems. For example, we can randomize scale. And even though this is a blue vector socket, we can in fact just plug in a single value input from this random value node and very quickly set the minimum and maximum scale. For my result, I used the minimum scale of 0.8 and maximum of 1.1. You can always go above 1 if your trees are too small. By the way, in your work, you don't always want to switch to this geometry nodes menu whenever you want to change some attributes. So what you can do to speed things up is to head into this input node, grab the gray socket, and drag it into, let's say, density vector. This way, you will be able to control this density directly from the modifiers menu. Quite a time saver. This is the same workflow that we're going to use to be able to drive the density of our instances based on the weight map that we've created. For that, we need to change this distribution method from random to this Poisson disk. I love this word. Poisson. I actually recommend deactivating your geometry nodes modifier before you do this, because a lot of points will be created and a lot of geometry with that. So yeah, deactivating the geometry nodes will speed things up. In the end, just lower this amount of density max to 0.02 again. Since the original density input doesn't exist anymore, we can get rid of it here in the group shelf menu and then use this new density factor socket. And now to plug our weight map that we created with the slope data into this window here, you just click this icon and choose it from the drop-down menu. Yes, that's how easy it is. And now whenever you want to control the density, you can just use this density max attribute and increase or lower it as needed. You can also drag it here, just as we've done previously. Finally, if you want to retain that constrained rotation of the billboards that automatically orient towards camera, just as we've done in the previous tutorial, we need to go a little bit differently about it in this geometry node setup. We need to use this object info node where we plug in the active camera. And then let's add another node. This time it's going to be this align Euler to vector. This one can basically process the rotation data of an object we input, in our case, the camera. When we plug it into the rotation of our instances, and wherever you go with the camera, the billboards are facing it. That's it. And now all we need to do is just join the geometry. So let's output these instances, use a join geometry node, and join the instances with this input here. With that, we've successfully replicated the particle setup. That's the second, more modern way to scatter your tree billboards in Blender. In my course, I dedicate a whole chapter to geometry nodes. So if you're interested in how I made, for example, this environment, you are welcome to join the Master 3D Environments in Blender. But with that, stay creative, my friends, and until next time, Martin out.